On a winter's night in 1945, I was lying in the ottoman. An ottoman's a padded seat that also serves as a chest. There were blankets and sheets in our ottoman, and sometimes there was me. When my sisters were downstairs and my mother was doing the washing and my father was in the pub, I used to lie in the ottoman in my parents' bedroom with the seat up, staring at the ceiling, pretending I was a motor car. My father chose this particular night not to go to the pub. I don't know why. It was not a choice he ever made again. I heard his heavy footsteps on the stairs. I froze. What would he say when he found me in his bedroom? He walked in. This was it, I thought. But it wasn't. He slammed down the lid of the ottoman. He didn't see me inside it. Why didn't I shout? I was too scared. That was the power of my father, you see. He sat on the ottoman and lit a cigarette. I was trapped underneath him till he finished his cigarette. I knew what would happen then. He'd break wind, stand up, cough, then cross to the window to spit out his phlegm. That's when I'd make my escape. Would he ever finish his fag? It was the fart that said, freedom. He crossed to the window, and I raised the lid.
Don't ever go in there again.
Sorry.
You'd have died if I hadn't got up. How would that make your mother feel, eh?
Sorry.
I'll teach you to nearly die.
He taught me to nearly die by nearly killing me. Inside the ottoman, along with the sheets and the blankets, was a tawse. A tawse was a strip of leather forked like the devil's tongue. My father beat me on the back of the legs over and over with that tawse. And then, at the end, he said,
kiss it!
I wanted to please him, so I kissed that tawse with tears in my eyes. But I thought about Susan Miller, the pretty little minx who lived next door. She was 9 too. I kissed the thing that hurt me, and I thought about the girl I loved. How many years of analysis would it take to unravel that? Even Woody Allen wouldn't get close. If he lived to be 1,000, imagine that. He'd make another 1,850 films. I've known many powerful men. My father was merely the first. And, of course, I've been a powerful man myself.
I believe for every drop of rain that falls, a flower grows.
I'm Richard Wilson. You're listening to Believe It. This is my radiography, the radio story of my life. My theme today is powerful men in my childhood and beyond. It's 1939. I am 3. I hear a whistling and a curious coming from the front room. The door's shut, but if I stand on tiptoe, I can see through the keyhole. There he is, my father, sat in a tin bath while my mother scrubs the coal dust off his back.
Hey, hey, harder, woman!
She's scrubbing his back with a broom.
Harder!
Of course. That explains it. My lifelong fetish for outsize instruments. To this day, if I see a rogue hair growing out of my nose, I reach for my garden shears. Even his tenderness was frightening. One night, he stood over me, catching his breath. Finally, he fell to his knees and whispered in my ear very loudly,
"You're the most beautiful wee girl in the world. Do you understand?"
"Yes, but the thing is..."
"Don't argue! You'll never get a husband if you argue. And grow your hair. Men don't like girls with short hair."
You never argue with powerful men. I'd learned that. But you can tweak their tails, can't you? You can flick them on the tail with your tawse so fast they don't even notice.
"I'm wearing it up."
"Huh?"
"I'm wearing my hair up."
"Oh, right. Women do that. Good night now."
He left, and me and my sisters giggled in the dark. It was the only victory I ever had over my father. A few days later, he died in the Duncannon disaster. A roof collapsed in the Duncannon pit, killing 9 miners. The Duncannon disaster made my father a martyr, a legend, a working-class hero. I felt proud and also, let's face it, annoyed. My father wasn't a hero. My father was a bully. That's what I said to my sister Rona the night he died.
He was a bully!
Oh, you can't say that. He's just died.
Was she right? Can you not speak ill of a man when he's just died? The night Hitler died, were you meant to say nice things about him? Oh, he did lovely watercolours, did Adolf. Oh, yes. When he painted a window, you could see right through it.
Dear Mrs. Wilson.
A few days later, my mother got a letter from the colliery owners.
We were sorry to hear about your late husband's death. We would like to express our gratitude for his 19 years of loyal service. We enclose a cheque for £4, 14 shillings and 10 pence as payment for his final shift. Please note that we have docked 5 shillings and tuppence as he did not complete the shift on account of his aforementioned death.
That's not fair, Ma. It wasn't his fault he died.
Well, let's not make a fuss.
That was when I understood. My father was the power that oppressed us, but there were powers that oppressed him. And so began my lifelong commitment to socialism. I became a junior member of the Greenock Labour Party. In my acting life, I've met many powerful men. Bullies like my father? No. A bully uses power for the sake of his own gratification. These men use power for the sake of art. The most powerful of them all are film directors. They have a vision. They see something inside their heads and they want to get it outside their heads where all of us can see it and enjoy it. That's a noble use of power, is it not? In 1970, I was cast by a film director of genius. He'd already directed The Killing, Paths of Glory, Spartacus, Lolita, Dr. Strangelove, and 2001. And now he was directing his own adaptation of Anthony Burgess's novel, A Clockwork Orange. That's right. In A Clockwork Orange, Stanley Kubrick cast me as the cafe owner. Malcolm McDowell, as a young thug Alex, beats up a tramp in an underpass with the help of the three friends he calls droogs. Then they stride into a greasy spoon in their bowler hats, white boiler suits and codpieces. I am the sour Scots owner of that greasy spoon, the man who brings in their teas and says, "There you are." My only line. What did Kubrick want from me? I was desperate to please him, as I had been to please my father. I walked up to the table, put down the tray, and said the line with venom. I showed those thugs that I knew they were thugs, and I had contempt for them.
183, take one.
Action.
There you are.
Again.
Again, said Stanley Kubrick. In take two, I said it with even more venom.
There you are!
Again?
Again, said Stanley Kubrick. In take three, I tried something different. I said the line politely, but I put down the tray with venom. There you are.
Again?
Again, said Stanley Kubrick. I was glad. I wanted to do it again. The slamming of the tray felt wrong. That's what happens when you only have one line. You try too hard to get noticed. Realism. That was the watchword for the next take.
There you are.
I waited and waited. Then I waited. Then Stanley Kubrick came up to me. He spoke to me.
Richard, isn't it?
Yes.
The way you did it then... That's realistic.
Thank you.
But it isn't interesting.
Right. Years later, I found out that's exactly what he said to Jack Nicholson when they were making The Shining. That's realistic, but it isn't interesting. I had to interest Stanley Kubrick, and I did. We did a dozen interesting takes, each one interesting in a different way. Just before take 16, I had an interesting revelation. That you in There You Are, it didn't have to be you, plural. I could direct the line to Malcolm McDowell as if I'd spotted he was the leader of the thugs.
183, take 16.
Action.
There you are.
Again.
Then I had another brainwave. Why didn't I say the line to Malcolm McDowell as if I'd heard about him from other cafe owners? He was this local thug I'd been told about and had been expecting to meet sooner or later in my own cafe.
183, take 17.
Yes.
There you are. Stanley, I feel I can call him that, said nothing. Of course he didn't. He didn't need to. His silence said it all. There you are was too interesting. In take 18, I tried something I knew would be interesting, but not too interesting.
183, take 18.
Do you see? I didn't say the line at all. I just put down the tray very quietly. But I knew, as soon as I did it, that it was not interesting enough. My blood was up now, though. I was buzzing with ideas. In take 37, I did this.
183, take 37.
Do you see? I made the tray say the line. I slammed the tray down three times to the rhythm of There You Are.
Again,
said Stanley Kubrick. Oh, thank you, Stan. The triple slamming was a total failure. The tea went everywhere, but that was the beauty of working with SK. He allowed you to fail. He encouraged you to fail. He made you fail because he knew that failure was a vital stepping stone on the way to success. After take 57, he came up to me and talked to me again. What a mesmerizing man he was, with his huge dark eyes and his soft voice. I'd be lying if I said I understood a word. My head was spinning. I felt dazed and weird. He was so close and so powerful. I nodded. I made intelligent noises. But Stanley Kubrick might as well have been speaking Hebrew.
Richard, listen to me.
Yes, Stanley.
Baruch Atur Adonai Elohenu Melech Chaolom.
Gotcha.
Shema Yisroel.
Aha.
Adonai Elohenu Adonai Echod.
Absolutely.
Baruch Shem Kavod Malchusau Liolom Voed.
Yep, I'm with you.
Does that make sense?
Absolutely. By take 66, I no longer knew what the words meant. There, you, are. They were just sounds, like unk or spang.
Okay, let's just do a few without stopping now. Just keep the camera rolling.
There you are! There you are! There you... Prompt.
Are.
Oh, thank you.
Again.
There you are! There you are!
Again.
Are you there?
Again.
Why, that was perfect.
You said, are you there?
You're wrong! Yes, I'm the man who told Stanley Kubrick he was wrong. Gone from the set in seconds. You never tell a powerful man he's wrong, even when he's wrong. Which he wasn't. Watch Clockwork Orange on DVD. You'll soon see which take is in the film. None. He cut the scene. I thought one of those 71 takes would be the one he wanted, but there you are.
There's no business like show business. Like no business I know.
If you're an actor who's suffered psychological abuse at the hands of a director, why not call our 24-hour actor abuse helpline? Well, for a start, it's in India, which is always annoying, and then there's a fear they won't have heard of you. No actor wants to spell his own name down the line to Bombay. Of course, I've directed many times. The question is, how have I used or abused my power? The director is part of the team. That's how I see it. I'm a democratic socialist. That's why 1997 was a great year. Democratic socialists came to power. I was with them all the way. Tony Blair ran into number 10. Consider this. What did Tony Blair have in common with his predecessor, John Smith, his Chancellor, Gordon Brown, and Robin Cook, and John Reed? That's right. Like me, they all had Scottish fathers. Alistair Campbell, his father was a vet called Donald. Derry Irvine, George Robertson, Donald Dewar, Peter McMandelson. So tartan was the court of Tony Blair that it was known in those early days as Tamalot. I recall one night at number 10 in the winter of 98 when Tony broke into song, accompanying himself on the guitar, a Scots song, of course, by Roderick David Stewart.
We are sailing, we are sailing home again.
I drink once a year on the anniversary of George Best's death. But that night, I didn't need to drink to feel drunk. I was drunk with power. It was like passive smoking. I was standing next to power, and the fumes went straight to my head. This man wasn't directing a film. He was directing a country. Round midnight, I found myself alone with Tony in the kitchen. I kept telling myself, agree with him, agree with him. There'd be no repetition of the Kubrick fiasco.
Well, what a delightful evening.
I agree. Very agreeable.
I have a strong sense that you're one of us, Richard.
I am one of you, Tony.
It's a Margaret Thatcher phrase. She was always asking if so-and-so was one of us. What do you think of Thatcher?
What do I think of Thatcher?
Yes, in retrospect. Now she's been out of office a few years.
What do I think of Thatcher in retrospect?
Yes, I mean, when you look back on her from this distance.
Can I let you into a secret, Tony? I think the same as you.
Well, I'm glad, Richard, because it's not exactly fashionable in New Labour circles, but you have to hand it to her. She won 3 elections, and she was a star, like Sean Connery.
Very much like Sean. You can imagine her saying,
the name's Thatcher, Margaret Thatcher.
You know Sean, don't you?
I do.
Can you get me his autograph?
Of course. I'll get him to make it out to Tony.
And why do you assume it's for me? I don't go around collecting autographs. I'm the Prime Minister.
No, sorry.
It's for a friend.
Of course. What's his name?
Tony. Another elderflower cordial?
No, thank you, Prime Minister. It's getting late. You probably want to go to bed.
Oh, that's tactful of you. I get up very early, as does my next-door neighbour. However early I get up, though, Gordon's up before me. Extraordinary capacity for hard work.
He has.
And exceptional analytical intelligence.
I agree, it was a brilliant idea to get the Bank of England to set interest rates.
That was my idea. I just let Gordon announce it.
Oh, well, getting him to announce it was a masterstroke. He announced it beautifully. I could hear every word. Don't dismiss me as the man who agreed with everything Tony said. I was more than that. I was the man who agreed with everything Gordon said, too.
Elderflower cordial, isn't it?
Thank you.
Didn't you join the Greenock Labour Party when you were a boy?
I did.
I believe you were aggrieved about your father's death in the Duncannon disaster. They docked his money, I believe.
That's right.
I'm so sorry.
Thank you. It's a long time ago.
51 years and 11 months.
Goodness. Is there anything you don't know?
No. Can I ask you something, Richard? Are you one of us?
I am.
Good. Tony's not a Labour Party tribalist like you and me. That's why he's so fearless about modernising it. What do you think of him?
What do I think of him? What do I think of Tony? I think the same as you.
I knew it!
Torn between two lovers, feeling like a fool. Loving both of you is breaking all the rules.
I loved having the two most powerful men in the country after Murdoch fighting over me. But to save myself from choosing one and being hated by the other, I withdrew from them both. They kept leaving messages.
Richard, it's Tony. How are you, mate? Why don't you pop round for a drink sometime?
Richard, it's Gordon. Are you free for a drink between 6.15 and 6.55 on Thursday the 27th of August?
My message was the same to both. Sorry, I'm directing a play in Sheffield. One night, in early 2001, I was flattered to find Alistair Campbell and Ed Balls in the bar of the Crucible Theatre after the show. They told me it was the best 12th night either had ever seen. Thank you, kind sirs, I said, though it was actually As You Like It. They'd come all the way from London to ask me to direct a party political broadcast for the 2001 election campaign. They had a code name for this broadcast, Operation Unity. Tony, you sit on the left, Gordon on the right, please.
Right you are. Gordon, you go there.
Okay, then.
And Tony, the tie's too bright.
Yeah?
Can we get the head of ties on the floor now? Operation Unity. Tony and Gordon side by side behind a desk, like a classic pair of newsreaders. The silvery wise older one and the crisp young lovely one with the gorgeous smile. Tony believed I was his man, as did Gordon. But so discreetly had I accepted and rebuffed their advances that I wasn't famous for belonging to either. In other words, I was the perfect mediator, the man who could bring them together. I told them the broadcast was my idea. They had to show the nation how united they were, despite what everyone thought. Of course, it wasn't my idea at all. I was just the front man for Campbell, the power behind Blair, and Balls, the power behind Brown. Brown, of course, was the power behind Blair, who was the power behind Brown. And now all that power was concentrated in me. Gentlemen, I'm going to film the whole thing in a two-shot, okay? So we can see both your faces throughout.
Gotcha.
Right, so we'll be the same size on the screen, yes?
Absolutely. Although...
What?
Well, one of you has a slightly bigger face.
Well, can't you make it smaller in the edit?
I think Richard's making a little joke, Gordon.
Oh, right. Very good.
Should we go for one, then? Autocue okay? Words big enough?
They're big enough for me.
What does that mean?
Nothing.
Because I'm older than you.
I can get you some glasses for your birthday.
Well, you know what I want for my birthday?
Oh, well, yes, but that belongs to me.
It does now.
Right.
Are we ready, gentlemen?
Yes.
Yes.
Then let us begin.
PBB, take one.
Action.
Gordon and I have a huge and important job to do for Britain, but we're not there yet.
We need your help. We need you to give New Labour a new mandate.
This election is about two central things. How we keep a strong economy with low mortgages and more jobs, and then make it stronger still.
And how we use that strength to invest in our future and in the services we depend on.
We face the threat of...
Gentlemen, can I stop you there? Gordon, when Tony's speaking, can you look more happy?
You mean like this?
No, he doesn't mean like that. He means happy. You're just doing your Gordon face.
Not doing my Gordon face. This is my face. You may do your face. I just have a face.
Let's go again. I'm sure it'll be fine. From the top, please.
PBB, take two.
Action.
Gordon and I have a huge and important job to do for Britain. But we're not there yet.
We need your help. We need you to give New Labour a new mandate. He's doing it again, isn't he?
What?
He's nodding.
How do you know I'm nodding? You're looking at the camera.
I can feel it.
What's wrong with nodding? I'm agreeing with you, for God's sake.
Well, stop agreeing, because it distracts the viewers from what I'm saying.
Richard, am I distracting the viewers from Gordon?
I like the nodding, but it might be better if you kept your head still and just nodded with your eyes.
Well, how do you nod with your eyes?
I'll show you. Look at me.
You look like a fish.
Maybe so, but a nodding fish.
I'm not taking advice from you.
You have to stop this. It's unprofessional. You have to unite on behalf of the cause. Do I make myself clear?
Sorry.
Yes, sorry.
They looked at me with a great desire to please. They looked at me like I used to look at my father, but without the fear. I just needed to make them suffer.
PBB, take three.
Gordon and I have a huge and important job to do for Britain, but we're not there yet.
We need your help. We need you to give New Labour...
It was the there that did it. Something clicked when I heard that there. Cut! Tony, this line, we're not there yet.
Yes?
The way you did that then, that was realistic.
Right.
But not interesting.
Ah.
Gordon, if you'll excuse us a moment, I just want to work on this line with Tony.
Oh, okay then. You want some privacy?
No, stay there, Gordon. Tony, can you just say the line for me, please?
Of course. We're not there yet.
Again.
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 We're not there yet. How do you want me to say it?
Just try it again, please.
I could stress the we. I mean, it's all about unity, isn't it? We're not there yet.
Again.
We're not there yet.
Again.
We're not there yet.
That's interesting, but it's not realistic.
We're not there yet.
Again.
We're not there yet.
Just do a few now. Energy. Energy!
We're not there yet. We're not there yet. We're not there yet.
Again?
We're not there yet. We're not there yet. We're not yet there.
You said we're not yet there.
Sorry.
Again?
We're not there yet.
Again?
We're not there yet.
Again?
This is wrong.
Don't tell me what's wrong. I've got a vision.
You're just trying to make him suffer. What kind of boss treats his workers like this? It's a total abuse of power. What the hell are you doing now?
I'm taking the boom from the Sandman and I'm using it to clean the wax from my ears.
You're mad!
You look like a girl. Do you know that?
You're mad. Tony's right.
Tony's right. That's what he said. I was there. It was one of the greatest days in the history of New Labour. The unity between them. Gordon Brown put his arm round Tony Blair, and that was my doing. I brought Tony and Gordon together. They united against me. They worked together in government for 6 more years, and every time the relationship threatened to fall apart, one of them would say to the other, "We're not there yet." And they'd giggle. Like my sisters and I giggled when my father left our room after I told him I was wearing my hair up. It's true. Every word you've heard is true. Or is it? Or is it?
Every time I hear a newborn baby cry, or...
You've been listening to Believe It, the radiography of me, Richard Wilson. I would like to thank my actor friends for their help in this endeavour. Lewis Macleod, John Sessions, Jane Slavin, David Tennant and Arabella Weir. I'd also like to thank my ghost writer, John Cantor, and my producer, Clive Brill of Pacificus Productions. And our hosts, BBC Radio 4.